I'll give you 10 minutes for the questions and then we'll wait. Why mantras are? There are various types of mantras. Some mantras are chanted to evoke the fire, which is the subject matter of the Vedas. That fire is not literally the fire you see, the fire that sustains the universe, the fire of life, the fire that created Brahma, the fire that created all the universe. Yes.
Could you elaborate on what you meant by the unconscious mind being semi-immortal? Does that mean?
Yes, I am
meaning that. You all should, if you understand this diagram well, anywhere you go on the earth, you listen to any speaker, you will not find that he is speaking something new. Oh, my teacher has already taught me this. If you understand one diagram, in that diagram, the whole process of evolution, meditation, everything is included. If I explain that diagram fully and systematically, it will take 1 year. You understand that. I will explain to you while explaining the mantras. Go ahead.
Yes, could you please elaborate on the visualization and practice of the seven tons of fire?
Seven tons of fire. I want to give you something which you have not heard before and something which is considered to be secret of the science of Tantra. Tantra does not mean sex. In the West, everybody thinks Tantra means sex. Tantra means way off. It's a very deep philosophy which was corrupted by the modern person. He didn't understand it. As priests use scriptures for their purpose, the science of Tantra was misused by the modern man. You see, there are three schools: the school of Kola. Even the most learned people, even in India, do not know which is the chakra where Kala worship is performed. They do not know, because they have read only books. They have not seen the real ceremony. They have not seen the ceremony. A girl never invites man or her husband to be her house for honeymooning. It's a common sense. Kundalini's home is Swadhisthana Chakra, her own abode. She remains sleeping because she takes nectar, thus deprives human soul. She nourishes herself in a way that she becomes intoxicated. So all that nectar which is needed for human being, she drinks that. That nectar drips from the human head. Now I'll tell you. Mishra group, worshipped here. Mishra means mixed. Not mixed in any bad sense, but both. They do worship at Mooladhara and at the same time do worship here, that is called mixed Mishra group. That's why there is a community in India, they are called Mishras among Brahmins. But they do not know why the name Mishra has been used. Actually, their forefathers were great tantrics, worshippers of the Lord Shiva. Shiva means Shakti and Shiva, male and female principle are inseparably one. Third is, first one, this is second one. First one is Mooladhara. For worldly prosperities, the tantric science says that male and female worship is here. To awaken Kundalini, remember that. All these worships are made to awaken that sleeping serpent-like fire, without which a human individual soul remains primitive. Why our society is full of primitive people? Why are we not aware of the truth when we carry that ultimate truth with us? Why are we ignorant when we are full of bliss and wisdom? That force, which is called prana here, first force, not the prana that you inhale, that creates the mind, that is the projection of mind. That first unit of life force, which is considered, which is called in English literature, in Western Hemisphere, as silver cord. Kundalini is that part. See, in human body, at the lowest chakra, at the root of your spinal column, there is a cavity where that fire remains in a sleeping state. Now, here this primal fire, 1, 2 and a half coil sleeps. She is intoxicated. What the yogis do? Okay, we understand now. They start drinking that nectar which is being taken by her. And she wakes up. She wakes up with all her tongues out, with fierce position. Karali means fierce. When you light a lamp or light, first color you find black, because the light is not full. Immediately fierce color comes. If you look at the lamp, that does not create musty fumes. And then watch it, those who do trataka, external gaze, they see all the colors. These colors are seen by the aspirants who have accomplished the external concentration by watching, by making their mind one-pointed, concentrating on the object called light, they burn. Now, she has a question of 7 tongues. When the yogi with the Khechri Mudra. Kha means space. Where is the space in your body? In the mouth. Chari means tongue, tip of the tongue. When you just put your tongue inward, put it on the palate and do certain exercises, don't do it. It will be not good to you if you do not know full exercise. Then, that tongue travels in the sky on the palate, touches it gently. From there, you receive two tastes. One is the taste of milk, not milk of cow, milk of mother. It's very tasty. Another taste is taste of ghee, clarified butter. It is not your choice which taste you acquire from there. It's the choice of your system, of your body. One is called Amrit Kala, another is called Swalp Kala. So those who receive Amrit Kala, they become like Shankaracharya, very slim, gentle, like a woman, beautiful person. Those who receive another kala, they get very strong. They can fight with elephant and tiger. You all have heard about Jesus Christ. How strong was he? He was a very strong person. Strong physically and mentally both. A spiritual person and very strong because his mind remains one-pointed. So mental equilibrium and physical tranquility both can do immense things, wonders in the world. So when yogis start taking that nectar which is being taken by the Kundalini serpent fire like, how does she take? There are three main tubes in your body. The spinal column. The center is called centralis canalis, and both sides are ganglionated tube according to medical science. You see. Inside the centralis canalis, there is another channel, energy channel, which is called Brahmani Nadi. It's exactly like two inside two, Chitrani and then Brahmani. Inside the physical tube, there are channels, and finest channel is called Brahmani. Brahmani means, if you tap that channel, you can easily go to the Brahman Rundra. That's why it is called Brahmani. This is called. After studying yoga manuals, I had to study anatomy because of this. My diploma is on anatomy. You see. To understand yoga science well, just to understand. So, they take that taste and those endings are here, inside, absorbed in the body. The poor girl remains without drinks. She gets angry when she wakes up. She doesn't get that intoxication again. So she gets very angry, fierce, with all her tongues out. You see. So there are 7 tongues she has, because she's a fire. So what does she do? She wants to find, search. First she goes to her own abode, Swadhisthana Chakra. Actually, that is a place of worship according to Kala group, not the here. That is why in Saundarya Lehri, the wave of bliss, and Shankaracharya bypassed that chakra because he was a Swami. The Kala group worships in Swadhisthana, because she is prepared to be wedded, then she goes to next Manipur Chakra. Now, it's action you are performing when you are doing, you are evoking fire. And yesterday I told you, the action, karma, is definitely inferior to the science of Brahman knowledge. Karma leads you to 4 stages. Creation, modification. Creation, like you bring a piece of wood, make a table out of it. Modification. You do modification of milk, make it butter. Third thing, what you do? Journey. You can go to your destination by doing action. Fourth is purification. You put gold into fire, it purifies. Action leads you to only 4 stages, not the 5th one. Action cannot emancipate, cannot give you emancipation, liberation. Knowledge is not action. So when a human being does tapa, it's action. Look at the difference. But the tapas of Brahman is not action, it's knowledge. And knowledge and action are two contrasts, two ends. Action will give you some result. Knowledge from the very beginning has its cause in knowledge, effect in knowledge. You see. So knowledge is different from action. There is no such action which leads you to Brahman, O human being. O friend of friends, O lover of the Atman and Brahman, there is no such action, there is no such ceremony that leads you to Brahman. Then why these actions are performed? Because we human beings cannot live without performing the actions. And I said, there are 3 categories of the actions. So when it is impossible for a human being or creature to live without performing actions, then he assumes duty and starts doing his duties, performing actions. When he reaps the fruits of actions, then those fruits motivate him to do more actions. And then it creates a whirlpool, and it's without end, and this is called samsara. The world in which we live continues because of this. Action echoes, reaction happens, and again another action comes, and this goes on, this is continuing. This is called samsara, the world of yours. So So remember, no action is will lead you to. Best of the actions that you perform, like charity. Why people do charity? Fools do charity to satisfy their ego, to show off others that I can give something. Or if they build a temple or hospital or something, they will put a big plate. Swami Rama has built such and such hospital. When they wanted to put my name, I said, stop doing that. I'll be beaten up. By my tradition, yes. I am not meant to have that. So there should not be any plate or any name on the hospital of Swami Rama. Even best of your actions, which is called selfless action, has no power to lead you to highest. Why it is called best of actions? Because you are caught not by actions, you are caught by the fruits of actions you receive therein. You hold, get attached to that heap of fruits you have received. You get attached. So wise men, those who are wise, performing the action, they say, how to get freedom from this hoarding business, from this attachment that we are creating for ourselves? There is no other way but giving to the others. Giving to whom? Giving to the Lord who is in you. So when I give something to the Lord, it becomes worship. Offering is not to the human being, for human being, but for the Lord who is in you. That's worship. So you are free from the attachment and there you are worshipping. You are becoming aware of the Lord of life all the time by giving. That is why love means giving. With the devotion you give, that's called love. You know the word bhakti. Bhakti has done very bad something. Women often do such things. You have not understood this joke so yet. Bhakti has compromised with mukti. Mukti means liberation. They postpone the idea of mukti. We are satisfied with the Saguna Brahman. The Brahman with attributes. Personal God. We like to worship, we need something personal. We like to worship personal God. There is nothing to worship. We cannot see, we cannot visualize, we cannot understand, we cannot touch. How it is possible for us to adore, to revere, to love? Saguna Brahman with attributes. As I have a home and I am the owner of the home, there is owner and proprietor of this whole universe, and he is Saguna Brahman, Hiranyagarbha. That Saguna Brahman, you start worshipping. Shankaracharya, the architect of Advaita philosophy, one without absolute, says, no, it's not going to help you. You are free from the bondages of karma by donating, by doing charities, but the highest of all the actions you can do, but it will not lead you to Brahman. Because no action has capacity to lead you to Brahman, final goal, truth. It's the truth. But it's not absolute truth. It's a truth that is used in relative world, but it's not the absolute truth. And you have to attain absolute truth. Therefore, you have to decide today that you cannot live without doing action. That is helplessness. And you are a master, you should be master of your actions. That's true. You should have purpose to perform the action. You should have a goal in your life to reach. But when you do perform your actions, you find that no action is capable of leading you. From where the actions are created? Not from your physical body thoughts. All your actions are virtually thoughts. Without thoughts, you cannot perform any action. Even when you are fast asleep and something you feel itching, a mosquito lands and you file back and itching that part. That is also a thought. A part of your mind remains awake and that sends a sensation to your body and then leads your finger to itch. So your action means, your emotion means, action, emotion, both means a particular thought. What is thought? A desire, which is a spark of karma. Why? Why this particular, you see, there are many yajnas done. Yogi does it to attain soma. That subject is coming. Soma yajna was very, soma ceremony was very famous. There is one cactus which is found at the height of 7,000 feet in the Himalayas that is considered to be the best for soma sacrifice. So they extract the juice of that cactus and that is called soma. So much research has been done on the word soma. In the monasteries, they don't distill wines there. But some, very few know what soma is. I explain in my book, Living with Himalayan Master. There are many such herbs which are intoxicating, their juices are intoxicating. But soma, actual soma, is extracted from, the finest of soma is extracted from that cactus which is found at the height of 7,000. This is one explanation, external explanation. Yogis receive soma. Because of the soma, she is intoxicated. That's why yogis receive, drink that soma, and she, with all her fears, anxiety, I am not getting drinks, she wakes up, pushes herself through the finest tube, piercing all the centers, and finally goes here. And that's called awakening of Kundalini. Yogi is prepared because he knows. Some people accidentally come in touch and when it awakens, it hurts. So this is very scientific method of awakening the sleeping energy, static energy, dormant energy, primal force, that which is in the reservoir in human body. Many of you have that, little bit. Sometimes she awakens, you become very creative, you start making poems. You start dancing very well. Artists do come in touch with that. Writers, artists, speakers, doctors, anybody who is above than average is because of the effect of Kundalini. It's energy. It's not like dumb energy like electricity. It's energy with brilliance, intelligence, wisdom. So you will see, when the Kundalini goes through the chakras, chakras change. No one understands this, but this is logical. Before the Kundalini passes through that, chakra is different. When Kundalini goes through that, chakra will be different. These descriptions of chakra you will find when Kundalini has not passed through it. They are like maps. You want to go to India? How India looks like? Ireland, how does it look like? Australia, how does it look like? It's like map. You see. So someone worship here, one group. This group, up to here, is called Rudra Khanda. There are three spheres. If you divide human body, this is human body. Brahma Khanda, Vishnu Khanda, or Rudra Khanda. In Brahma Khanda, this comes in Brahma Khanda, only this chakra from here to here. Ajna Chakra, there are many other chakra, Guru Chakra. There is a tunnel here which is called Bhramar Guha. And then by piercing the pearl of wisdom, you go to Brahmanundra. Dropping your body, going through this chakra is considered to be highest. Another. This and this Vishnu chakra. Vishnu Khanda. Swadhisthana? No. This chakra is called? Vishuddha chakra and Anahat chakra. And three chakras in Rudra Khanda. Call as know the worship. Right, up to this. Another group does worship here. But highest group is called Samaya. I am with you. When you feel presence of the Lord all the time, what do you do? Lord is with me, I am with the Lord, Lord is with me. There are three stages. I exist and Lord exists, you become aware of this. Another step is, I am with the Lord and Lord is with me. I am thine and thou art mine. But that's not perfect stage. Jesus Christ said, I and my Father are one. That's the last stage. That's the state of self-realization. Why did he say to this? Whom? To his students, he said, I and my Father are one. Because he was explaining this. So when you have gone through three states systematically, finally you realize, I and my Father are one. That is self-realization, self of all. When you don't have body consciousness, mental consciousness, pranic consciousness, ego consciousness, your consciousness is consciousness of the Brahman. That's called self-realization. Now, the path of Samaya is the highest one. I was trained in that path. In which you do not need to perform some sort of rites like men and women live. That is meant for the householders. Then this is meant for those who have got capacity to understand this puja and at the same time. This is meant only for yogis. Their place of worship is the crown of the head, Sahasrara Chakra. But for worshipping there, how do you go there? You go through a tunnel. In the tunnel, at the end of the tunnel, there are three bindus, three pearls. Red, blue, and white. That's why you will find symbols like Shiva's color is blue. Some of the gods look white and some of them look red. They are actually three bindus which a yogi has to pierce before he goes to worship three gates. He goes to worship in the Sahasrara. There you will find Shiva and Shakti one. They are not two there. Two principles which are seen, two here, this is because of hypnosis. I am hypnotized, I see you in many. If I come out of hypnosis, I will see only one reality everywhere. It's within and without. If you are as long as you are hypnotized, you see many. When you are in real senses, you realize that you will see only one. Now, who is showing you this manyness? I will tell you, Maya. Now, what is that Maya? It means Maya is more powerful than your soul or than Brahman. No, that's not true. The word Maya, when time is over, let me know, huh? Maya. Ma means no, ya means that. It's not like thou art that. Thou art not that. It actually does not exist. But it seems to exist, and one of the phases of Maya is mirage. When you drive your car, you see what is substance in, you see in front of you, but when you go there is nothing. Mirage. One of the phases of Maya. You think that you live in the world, and this world is real? I can promise, and I tell you, if we discuss, I will convince you this world is not real. This is unreal world. Why is it unreal? Because it does not stay as it is forever. It changes. And that which changes cannot be called real. Then, the so-called world is full of names and forms, and names and forms change. If the form is changed, the name is changed. When there is wood, you don't call it table. Same wood is made into table, you call it table, because form has changed. When forms and names change, that cannot be called real. There is only one point for calling it real. Because its origin is real, so it should be real. It has come from the truth. How truth can create something untruth, how real can create something untruth, how unreal can come from the real. This is the point. Only one point. It's effect. World is effect. The effect should have some cause. There are two types of cause. Material and efficient cause. What is the cause of this world? The cause of this world is Brahman. That Brahman is called Saguna Brahman. It is imperishable, but it is not perfect as Nirguna Brahman, unmanifested Brahman. Subject has become tougher, I'm sorry, and you have to go with it. Why do I say that this is unreal? This is unreal because it's like dream. In dream, you have become a king. You don't have anything to eat, even square meal, even a cup of tea and a loaf of bread, you don't have anything. But you are dreaming that you have become a king. And whole world is controlled by you. And entire heaven is at your service. For 2 hours you dreamt. During your dream, you are a king, and that's true. It's called dreaming reality. As dreaming reality is true for 2 hours, for a few years, this waking reality is also true. But it's like dream, it's another dream. It does not last for a long time. Truth means that which exists forever and ever without any change, decay and death. That is called truth. Therefore, this world is unreal. For unreal world and to live in it, you have to have a science that is called lower science, avidya. The vidya, the knowledge that is imparted by the ancient, because it's a lower knowledge. How to perform your duties, how to do your practices in the world. They are limited to your sense gratification. They are limited to the heaven. They lead you to heaven. And once your karmas are exhausted, you come down again. You are not liberated. You are not free. You are always in the bondage. Unless you destroy all the fetters, you are not free. Now, some people say, why do you want to destroy the fetters? Let us be born again and again. Let us be born with that consciousness of Brahman. I want to be born in this world and serve others, say, Arhat, enlightened one. He's enlightened one, but he wants to come back, and he's willing to come back, and he comes back with all his consciousness to the world to serve others. For him, there is no work to be done. He is not in the bondage of death and birth, but he comes to serve others, to help others, to guide others. The light of the sun is not in the bondage of the world. And because of that light we see, they come like lights, devas, to this world, show the path and go away. One category of enlightened people. So virtually there is nothing, no difference between a universe of the forms and names and universe without forms and names. Unmanifested one and manifested one reality. Now, the scriptures we start. Just as a great fire manifests thousands of sparks which share its nature, when the sparks come out of the fire, one spark is not cold and another spark is not hot. All sparks are akin. They have the same nature because they have come out of their cause, fire. All the sparks can come out. So the manifold world evolves from the indestructible and is absorbed back into it again. As the sparks come out of the fire and again go back. Now, a little simile will help you. Recently I heard that there was 124 temperature in Texas or somewhere in the country, Phoenix, Arizona. Can you cook your food in that temperature? No. Because that energy is scattered. But in 124 degree, you can cook food if it is concentrated. There is heat in the atmosphere. Can you cook your food in that heat? No. You have to concentrate that energy from the atmosphere to the powerhouse and through a channel, then you is in your cooking place. Concentration. When you learn to concentrate your energy, which is being dissipated by your senses, by many avenues of your body, you can do wonders. Learning to channelize your energy is called control. When you realize what Atman is, we all are sparks, we are not fools, we are not bad people, we are not evil, we are not devil, we all are sparks of Atman, Paramatman. We are bubbles in that great ocean of the universe. Why should we condemn ourselves? Because we identify ourselves with the body, which is perishable. We don't identify ourselves with the imperishable. The moment we go home and say, no, I am Atman. There is no death for Atman. Atman cannot lose. Its nature is pure. Happiness and bliss. You are happy. But when you identify yourself with the external, that which is constantly changing, fastly fleeting, then you get sad. You cry. You get attached to the imperishable, forgetting your true nature. Now, here comes the word Purusha. Purusha, the supreme consciousness. What do you mean by Purusha? This word means? Pur means city, Sa means sleeping. One who is sleeping in the city of life is called Purusha. Another name of Atman is Purusha. Deeply buried in the tomb of your body is your soul, the jewel. You have to gently, without destroying the tomb, dig and without hurting any part of yourself, dig out the jewel that is called Atma. It pervades both internal and external world. It is perfect and unalloyed. There is no mixture in it. And transcends even any manifest primal, primordial nature, Prakriti. From this evolves prana, life energy. Now, diagram comes. Here you will learn how this universe was, came into evolution. If you say, Swamiji, how did you learn all this? I didn't do anything except learning this. You did many things. You see, I'm a fool in many ways, and you are a fool in many ways. So we are fools. See, I include myself, there's no problem. In the vast universe of the bliss is a great joy, inexplicable joy. If there is a movement, and that is Satyam Shivam Sundaram, that the waves are in that great bliss, that universe, that ocean of the bliss. One wave is truth, another is beauty, another is ananda, bliss. The silent movement is going on there. From there arises a bubble that is called spark or atma. You see, your atma, individual soul. It is not individual, it becomes individual, it is not individual as yet. It is in the ocean, so it is not individual. It is ocean. It becomes individual when this light, prana, its actual prana, the life force, comes forward, creates mind, unconscious mind, then comes conscious mind, then comes your breath, two breaths, and then comes your body. I told you, if someone asks you, who are you? Are you a citizen of only one country? If you ask me, I say no. You are lowering down my position. I am citizen of three worlds. Mortal, semi-mortal, and immortal. You are three selves. A self is called mortal. Body is mortal. Breath, parts, mortal, conscious mind, fails, mortal. This is called mortal part of your body. Whenever you read any book, you remember this. Mortality in mortal is body, breath, and conscious mind. Semi-immortal. Unconscious mind, where you store all the sanskaras, impressions of your life, experiences, the great account book, the great canvas on which you paint, bed of memory, storehouse of merits and demerits, here. Including this and this life force and this, these three are called semi-immortal. Why immortal? Because mortal, immortal is there, but it has a vehicle, it has a force. That's why it has become immortal, individual. It's individual. It is in the ocean, but having this individuality. Now, it becomes perfectly immortal when it drops this superimpositions. These are impositions. I have a body is imposition. When you are in deep sleep, why do you not feel that you have a body? When you are sleeping, why do you not remember that you are son of such and such? Suddenly you find yourself something great and you forget even your name and all that. You see. So you are three selves. When we talk of real self, we are talking of this self. When we talk of mortal self, we are talking of this self. So when you study any book, remember which self you are talking of. Are you talking of body? Are you talking of your unconscious mind? When this body drops, this still remains. Now you understand the definition of death. Death means separation. Unity means life. When these both parts are united, this is life. When they are separated, this is called death. So death does not mean complete annihilation. You don't die even after death. You remain alive after death. But without breath, conscious mind and body, you remain this way. Individual soul, life force, dormant force and unconscious mind. Now you have desires here to fulfill. Good desires are motivating you. The life force to project forward. You start breathing, you become a human being. How do you become a human being in the process of evolution? It is coming. Next. From this evolves prana, life energy. Then evolves mind. Then evolve all the senses, space, air, fire, water and earth, which supports the whole world. In the process of evolution, first this bubble comes, then the life energy, then the mind, then the prana, breath, then the body. This is evolution. What the yogi does? Yogi reverses this. Why should I be in such a pain? Why should I be with my mortal self? I'll be in my complete immortality. Then they have power to remain in mortal self, remain in mortal both. Now let me tell you. The seers of the Vedic age were far more superior than the avatars. Indian communities started worshipping avatars because they did not know how to learn, how to receive, how to practice the wisdom of Vedas. So they started adoring their leaders, great leaders, Rama and Krishna. I don't say they are bad. No. They are great men. But they cannot be compared with the seers. What Rama and Krishna did, they could not give anything new to the world. They gave only the same philosophy in a modified way and like Krishna. Sarvopanishado gao dukta goval nandana. What Krishna did? He made entire Upanishadic literature like a cow, became a milkman, and that milk was given to Arjuna, and that dialogue was called Gita. Seers of Vedic age receive Shrutis, knowledge, direct knowledge, and any knowledge came from any avatara is a smriti, it cannot be called Shruti. Therefore, seers of Vedic age, ancient time, were far more superior than any avataras. That was called Satyaloka. That cycle was called cycle of truth. No one knew how to speak lies. No one knew anything but truth. Everyone was in bliss. You see. In Treta Yuga, next cycle, then they started performing yajnas and doing the actions. Degeneration came. In Dwapar, they did many other practices. In Treta, they do nothing but chanting. Slowly, that is spirituality. It is that going through final filterization, it goes through gutters. And we are degenerated. Let us seek for the dignity. O man, you have to seek for the prestige and dignity, your true self. O human being. So in Kali Yuga, in Dwapara and Treta, they perform Agni Yagriyas to kill the animal in human being so that he realizes that he is a spiritual being. But they could not. Individuals were able to do that. They could not train the whole masses. Fortunate few were realized, were wise, but they could not attain the absolute reality. In Kali Yuga, where a human being is scattered, what is the way for him? He can realize even today, you see. Next chapters are very beautiful chapters, and now there was one sage, the great sage of our times. There are two great sages like Kabir Das Ji and Sri Nanak Dev Ji. They both said something about the universe and the Lord. How do we say that Lord of the universe is inexplicable? He says, Saat Samudra ki Masi Karo. All six, seven sevens I use as the ink. Lekhan Sab Ban Rai. And all the woods in the world, I use it as my pen. Dharti main kagat karo. Entire earth, I use it as paper. Har gun likha na jaye. I cannot write. All the ink will be exhausted. All the paper will be completed. But I cannot complete. Praising the Lord. How great the Lord is. The bhaktas lost over the Lord, of the Lord, talk about the Lord of life like this. Here, to inspire the student and aspirant, say, fire is the head. The moon and sun are the eyes of that Brahma. All four directions are the ears. What did he speak? All Vedas, all the knowledge containing in the Vedic literature is his speech. Ear is his prana, all this ear that we find. This universe is his heart. Earth itself has emerged from his feet, and he alone is the inner self of all living beings. having the sun as now. First, he describes about the universe. Now, the share of the Upanishad describes about our world. Our world means our solar system. Having the sun as its source of energy. Today, still the science is primitive. Upanishad, some thousands of years ago, said, sun is the source of energy. Why are they not tapping that energy? They go to Middle East for the energy, fuel. You see. Solar energy is considered to be the real source. If there is no sun, there will be no energy anywhere. From that sun, who is called sun of sun, from that truth, who is called truth of truth, satyasa, satyam, truth of truth, evolves, from him evolves fire, from him also evolves soma, the second stage of fire, now you see. Here, the word soma, sacrifice or soma, ceremony, is totally yogic. Soma, that which I was describing, one external, one meaning of soma is, it's herb, like cactus found in over 7,000 feet, the extract, they make soma wine, and when they drink soma wine, they sit in meditation for a long time without any problem. One crude way of putting yourself into meditation. Many people tried to take that soma. The fourth chapter of Yoga Darshana says that there are herbs that lead you to deep meditation. The Westerners flew away with this idea and started taking drugs and started hallucinating, and they say that this is Kundalini. I experienced it in New York. I came to New York, there was one Swami, Westerner Swami. He said, you have to speak. First time to come to. Do you want to see what my subject was? Awakening of Kundalini. But he said, wait, Swami, my students are very enlightened. Be careful when you speak. I said, what do they do? Their Kundalini is awakening, awakened. I found everybody is closing eyes and doing like this. I did not know what to do. So I said, Mr. Guru, you know, I'm not so much enlightened. They were all drugged. She understood. I told him quietly, whispered, I said, look here, I'm not a fool. Don't tell me, don't ask me to speak here. They are induced by drug. That's why they are doing like this. You see a medical sign where you will find like this. That is actually picture of the energy flowing from pelvic to medulla to pelvic to medulla. That's why this is a medical sign. This purely yogic sign of the energy channels. Pida, Pingala and Sushumna. When we come to know how to use the soma, which is subordinate to the universal fire. That fire is not the mere fire, fire of knowledge. Have you seen a Swami wearing arka robe? That is the color of fire. It means he has burned all his worldly desires into that color and then he wears that. Soma fire is used for the attainment of samadhi. This happens when you constantly light a fire in your manipura and give prana ahuti all the time. You attain samadhi, the state of samadhi. Where? What is samadhi? Samadhi is a state which converts, it's like alchemy, which converts a human being into sage. A fool becomes a sage. That is samadhi. You see, deep state of meditation. From soma comes rain. You see. Now, I was talking to you about the nectar that drips. It has come from the source called soma, according to yogic science. But in the external world, this rains that you find comes from the soma. Means there are clouds which rain. You see. Anybody who has read yogic manuals, they say, dharma megha samadhi. As pilot goes, attains the height, he meets clouds, they are called black clouds, very dangerous. Sometimes black clouds are so heavily laden with the water, so heavily, they can even break the wings. If pilot is not, navigator is not intelligent, he might meet accident because of the pilot. When pilot meets, pilot is not afraid of anything in the sky but of the black clouds. A yogi is not afraid of anything in deep meditation, but at final stage he meets dharma megha, which leads him, which finally takes him after going through that. It rains. He has to go through that. Torrents of rains. Thundering cloud, rain, and then he goes beyond and attains samadhi. Just as a man plants a seed in a woman and thus life ensues, so with the aid of Purusha do numerous beings evolve from Prakriti. Now, we often say, there is a controversy. When life enters into a womb, I told you, there is heat all over. Life is all over. Life is already there. But it is in unmanifested form. So you cannot kill life in unmanifested form. Do you have a weapon to kill the heat that you have in the atmosphere? But when this atmospheric energy is brought into one place in a powerhouse, then it is used in a particular form, air conditioner, heater. You can break the heater and the air conditioner. Nothing happens to the life. Life goes to life. The moment sperm is received by ova, That moment is the moment of real birth. Life is already there. You see. Therefore, ancients knew how to discipline themselves. Wife and husband would meet only occasionally to bring the child to the world. Now, from him also come forward the mantras of the Rig Veda, Sama Veda, and Yajur Veda. All these Vedas, which were compiled by Vyasa. Now, same Vyasa was author of Mahabharata. That's why Westerners are confused. They say Vedas are not so old, they are only 24,000 BC, 2400 BC. How do you say that they are ancient scriptures? Because Vyasa is compiler of Mahabharata and Vyasa is compiler of that. How one man can live for so many generations? For such people, I have answer. It was Vyasa was not a person. Himalayan Institute is not a person. It's institute. Vyasa was an institute. The name of the institute was Vyasa. One after another, there was a lineage where the scholars did the same work. If Swami Rama goes away, another Swami will teach you the same thing, yoga, this and that and that. Therefore, the date cannot be said when for the first time Vedas came into existence. Knowledge is knowledge, it is eternal. Nobody has created knowledge. Whether it has come to Christian Bible, to Vedas, through any other source, knowledge is always eternal. It is not action. It is no one's property. It has come from the Absolute One. The concept of making fire, giving offerings, has come from him, from the knowledge. From him also develops the unit of time, year, month, and the aspirants who strive to perform rituals as well as the whole world, which is purified, illuminated, are sustained by Soma and Surya. Surya is sun, Soma is that power which is little bit lower than sun, but the great power of powers, and yogis enjoy that. From him evolve manifold celestial beings, are here. Are you and me having bodies can be called celestial beings? No, we are called human beings. Do they sometimes relate and communicate with the human beings? Possible. Those human beings have knowledge of going to higher state in meditation or with some worship ceremony, they communicate with them. So there are celestial beings also. which cannot be communicated by everyone. Christian religion, Islam, all religions believe in that. All scriptures say there are celestial beings. Without body, beings without body. Good celestial beings do help us. If there is any hindrance, they do. One day I was remembering a mantra and I was missing a little part of the mantra. Sitting under a tree, banyan tree in the forest where there was nothing except fire and me. Suddenly I find a turban type coming down. There was no human being, nothing else. And you don't hallucinate when you see something face to face. And the voice came, look here. The mantra which you are remembering is not right. It is not giving you right effects. Better remember this way, this is right. I said, how do I know that you are a good soul? Not misleading me. The voice giggled and said, no, I have no desire to hurt you. I said, unless I consult the scriptures, verify what you say, I'm not going to follow you. He said, don't follow, you'll be wasting your time. It took me 3 days to get the scripture from the town, from a pundit, and I verified whatever he said was right, and I was doing wrong. So there are celestial beings which help us often. Sometimes you don't see them, sometimes you have a glance, sometimes you don't have a glance, sometimes their protecting hands help you. Many kingdoms, the kingdom of rocks, animals, birds, all that, from the same source have appeared. From him evolved the sevenfold pranas. Now, according to yoga manuals, there are 72,000 nadis, channels, energy channels. But the vehicles which are known by the yogis, they are 10. Here he says, the share of the Mundaka Upanishad says, sevenfold pranas. He's not talking about the breath. The breath is not prana. Breath is like a horse and the rider is called prana. Someone is riding the breath, using it as a horse, and that's why it is leading to different parts of my system. It is something living. Who is directing the prana? Otherwise this dead air which blows from one part to another cannot do anything. So prana is something very living, at the same time brilliant and with full of intelligence. This sevenfold pranas is this. This is sevenfold. This Shakti, which is capable of projecting the power of the individual soul, that's why it becomes individual, is sevenfolded. Not the prana here. that which resides in the cave of the body, heart. The sevenfold pranas continue their journey. That's why a human being grows. Have you seen a blue child? Blue child is that child which has got hole in one of the chambers in the heart. So arteries and veins, they become one. The blood is not purified. Do you see that his growth is stunted? These sevenfolded pranas which dwell in the cave of the heart, the energies, different energies, they are responsible for our growth. That's why we go to seven. Why it is called sevenfolded? Count one by one. You have not asked me why. You are born first. You become a child second. You become adult third. You grow more to a stage of manhood fourth. You go to death. These are seven stages that you attain in your lifetime. It's in growth. Death is a part of growth. It's not something different. If you understand the channels of energy which reside in the cavity of heart, then you will know. Those channels in the universe, this body is your miniature universe. But outside the universe, these energies, sevenfolded pranas, are responsible to manifest themselves. And that's why there are mountains, rivers and everything in the universe. The essence of all is Purusha consciousness. What is the essence? What is the cause? That sleeping splendor, that sleeping consciousness within us, seed. Now, if you have a seed in your body and I say, my dear student, believe me, I am holding a tree, you'll say, something has happened to our teacher, he's crazy. But actually it's true that there is a tree in it, you are not seeing. The seed contains a tree, even flowers and fruits. See, if I tell you, I have fruits in my hand and I have a little seed, I am also right and you are also right. I am right because if you allow this seed to grow, it will become a tree, the seed will break and there will come a tree. There is energy inside, power inside, which has got two power. To throw roots to the ground, to grow upwards. And then it gives flowers, and then it gives fruits. So I'm not wrong. All the gems, all the essence is in the seed. That seed contains everything. One of the homeopathic doctors in Germany said, someone told him, what a foolish thing have you done after doing MD and your surgery, you became homeopath? How is it possible? You give a drop of medicine and say you will be cured? Stupid. You know what he said? He said, you have forgotten that you are made out of a drop. You don't need more than a drop. When we go to the essence, It's Purusha is the essence, that sleeping, dormant power is essence in us. That is very essence. And once we allow it to grow, awaken, then we can do wonders in the world. He who knows Purusha residing in the cave of the heart, which is situated between the two, where upper hemisphere and lower hemisphere meet, his knot of ignorance is destroyed. When in this lifetime, you can do it in this lifetime, destroy that knot of ignorance which gives you fear, which creates bondage for you, which gives you many fears, depressions, pains, miseries, you can be liberated here by that. This is today's lesson.